डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब अंबेडकर ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी।
नमस्कार स्टूडेंट्स, आई डॉक्टर बिनी वाघेला, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर फ्रॉम इंग्लिश डिपार्टमेंट, स्कूल ऑफ ह्यूमैनिटीज एंड सोशल साइंसेस, डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब आंबेडकर ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी, वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस वीडियो लेक्चर सीरीज ऑफ फर्स्ट ईयर बैचलर ऑफ आर्ट्स इन इंग्लिश। इन दिस सेशन आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस यूनिट नंबर 15, द स्प्रेड एंड राइज ऑफ इंग्लिश, फ्रॉम पेपर नंबर 2, इंट्रोडक्शन टू इंग्लिश लैंग्वेज एंड स्ट्रक्चर। द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द सेशन इज इंट्रोडक्शन, द ओल्ड इंग्लिश, द मिडल इंग्लिश, द मॉडर्न इंग्लिश, थियरीज ऑफ ओरिजिन ऑफ लैंग्वेज, इंडो यूरोपियन फैमिली ऑफ लैंग्वेजेस, ईस्टर्न ग्रुप, वेस्टर्न ग्रुप, रीजन्स बिहाइंड द स्प्रेड ऑफ इंग्लिश, the Bible translations, influence of Shakespeare and influence of Milton. Let's start with the introduction part. The gift of speech and well-ordered language are characteristics of mankind and are the symbol and token of the boundary between man and brute. Language has been nicely defined by Edward Sapir as a purely human and non-instinctive method of communicating ideas, emotions, and desires by means of a system of voluntary produced symbols. It is the universal medium for conveying our thoughts or feelings to others. There are other means of expressing our mind to others. Gesture is of these means. We hear of certain people whose vocabulary is so limited that they cannot get on without the supplementary use of gesture, so that intelligible conversation becomes impossible for them in the dark. It is difficult to see adequately the functions of language, because it is so deeply rooted in the whole of human behavior that it may be suspected that there is little in the functional side of our conscious behavior in which language does not play its part. The primary function of the language, as we know, is communication. Language is also a great force of socialization. Apart from the fact that no significant social intercourse is possible without the language, the common language serves as a peculiarly potent symbol of the social solidarity of those who speak the language. A group of people is held together by the ties of common language. English is spoken and read not only in England and the United States, but also in many countries of the East and West. It is now spoken as a second language throughout the world. Though historical, political, and economic factors have much to do with this worldwide extension of English, there are qualities and characteristics inherent in the language itself to which English owes much of its ever-increasing global appeal. Historians of the English language distinguish three main stages of its development. The first is the Old English period. This is followed by the Middle English period. And finally, there is the period of modern English. These divisions need not be watertight, for the development of a language is never sudden, but is a gradual process. However, it can be seen that at times this process of change is more rapid due to a variety of reasons. Now let's discuss with the old English. The earliest inhabitants of the British Islands were the Britons, and they spoke a form of Celtic language. It had all similarities with the language spoken in some districts of northern France, which is now called Britain. After this, Anglos, Saxons, Jutes, and tribes from North Germany descended with their hordes, and the supremacy of Celtic language rapidly came to an end. By 600 AD, they had succeeded in establishing their power fairly, firmly, and implanting their language in Britain. Critics call this language Old English to stress the continuity of speech and the connection of this early form with the language which is spoken today. The Old English language had many dialects, but of all the dialects, that of Wessex became the most important. This was because this region was the most civilized, had an ordered form of government, and most of the literature of this period was written in the dialect, from which the work Beowulf still survives. However, traces of other dialects still survive. It is the Old English with its several dialects that has given to us doublets or two words with only a slight difference in its meaning. They were originally dialectal variants of the same word. However, in a northern dialect, the change did not take place, and hence we now also have the word hell. Anglo-Saxon had a very complicated grammar. Nouns had three or four case endings. It was also highly inflected, just as modern German is today. The vocabulary of Old English was chiefly Germanic, though some words came from the language of Celts. Every word has pronounced according to its spelling, and there were no silent syllables. The Roman occupation too had its impact on the Anglo-Saxon tongue. Now let's discuss the Middle English. The conquest of England in 1066 by William of Normandy had a profound influence not only upon the history and political system of the country, but also upon the language. English now became a much more hybrid language. In the beginning, two languages were spoken side by side: Old English and Norman French. Gradually, these two languages mingled to give what is known as Middle English. The modern English descended from this mixed Anglo-French tongue. The Norman French, which was the language of the rulers, enjoyed greater prestige and was used as the language of the aristocracy. While the Old English was the language of the general public, however, the mixed language had a fewer French words. Meanwhile, Latin was still used for learned works. Literary English developed with the growth of London as a center of commercial, political and legal life towards the end of the 14th century. The East Midland English assumed a dominant position now because it was spoken in and around the London. Oxford and Cambridge also used it, and hence it became the language of scholarship. The received standard English of today is said to have descended from this dialect. Chaucer and number of other prominent writers of that time used it. Hence, we find Chaucer to be intelligible to the modern readers. Finally, the introduction of the printing by Caxton brought many changes at the end of this period. During this period, there were changes in grammar, pronunciation, spellings, and there were additions to the vocabulary. This period also marks the loss of some of the inflections. Hence, it is called the period of leveled inflections. Phonetic development of the Middle English period was the lengthening of short vowels when they stood in open syllables and the shortening of long ones in closed syllables. The discrepancy between spelling and pronunciation began in this period. The existence of two languages side by side gave rise to synonyms, one from the native tongue, while the other was from the Norman French. The French also established the beginnings of the modern legal system, and so a number of new words were introduced into English from French. Now let's discuss the modern English. On the advent of the Renaissance, the full flood of the new learning reached England at about the year 1500, and this affected the English language too. The Renaissance was chiefly a Latin one, and hence Latin words were introduced into English vocabulary in great numbers. The Reformation was an outcome of the spirit of criticism generated by the Renaissance. The bitter religious controversies gave rise to numerous words, a very important outcome of the Reformation was the various English translations of the Bible, the chief being Tyndale's in 1526, and more important was the Authorized Version in 1611. The Bible played an important role in fixing the English language and setting a kind of standard. Many more inflections were lost in this period. Printing too played an important role. The printers of Queen Elizabeth's time fixed the spelling according to the pronunciation that existed during the late Middle English and early modern English period. However, the pronunciation changed considerably after that, but not the spelling. Hence, the pronunciation was not phonetically reflected in the orthography. Hence, the English spellings are largely symbolical of thoughts and are not always phonetic representation of the actual sound of the words. Now, let's discuss some of the theories of the origin of language. The first is Bowo theory. This theory supposes that human speech originated in man's attempt to imitate the sound of nature. Thus, a dog might be called a bow wow or a cow moo. There is no denying the fact that such imitation accounts for a certain number of words in the English vocabulary, that is cuckoo, hiss, gurgle, whistle, whine, babby, prattle, etc. These words are the example of this theory, that is the bow wow theory. Words that have this origin are sometimes said to be onomatopoeic. Second theory is ding dong theory. This theory propounds that specific kinds of objects are so affected the primitive man as to ring out of them correspondingly specific utterances. For example, the words like jig-jag, diesel may be cited as examples. Third is the poo-poo theory. This theory seeks the origin of language in such involuntary exclamation of pain, surprise, wonder, disapproval, pleasure, for example, oh, bah, such like that. As a theory of origin of language, it stands upon a very slippery ground. Now let's discuss the last theory, that is gesture theory. This theory holds that language originates in gesture. The gesture theorists opine that the primitive people communicated with one another by the means of gestures made by hand, and ultimately the language equivalents were substituted for these gestures. In saying I and me, the lips are drawn inward, as if pointing to the speaker. And in saying you and though, the lips are moved outwards as if pointing to the person addressed. Similarly, in saying here and there, the lips are drawn inwards and thrown outwards respectively. Insofar as these theories are acceptable at all, they explain only small parts of the language. It is very hard to see how they can be extended to account for all the languages. We may have some ideas of the origin and development of language by observing the way in which a child learns to speak. It is almost certain that a good deal of language had its origin in a process parallel to that by which a child first pronounces meaningless groups of sounds to which meanings are afterwards attached either by the child itself or by its hearers. A notable stage in the history of language was reached when significant sounds began to be handed down from one generation to another. And then imitation came to play an important part in the development of the language. Now let's discuss Indo-European family of languages. The Indo-European family of languages is the most widespread group of languages in the world. And from it, almost all the languages of Europe and Western Asia are said to have descended. We have no written records of this great language family, but the modern researches have revealed that Sanskrit, Greek, and other languages retain a great many grammatical and linguistic peculiarities. We can divide the Indo-European family of languages into two groups, Eastern group and Western group. Now let's discuss some of the reasons behind the spread of English language. There are a number of reasons behind the spread of this international language. Some of them are as we discuss now. Prominent among the characteristics of this language must be mentioned its extraordinary receptive and adaptable heterogeneousness. The varied ease and readiness with which English has taken to itself materials from almost everywhere in the world and has assimilated these outside elements are wonderful. This general receptiveness of new elements from anywhere in the world, which helps to make English a suitable and attractive vehicle in so many parts of the world. In the matter of inflectional simplification, English has gone much further than any European language. The manner English has reduced the endings it once had to a minimum is really wonderful. Now let's discuss the Bible translations. The translations of the Bible from those of Tyndale and Coverdale in the early 16th century to the authorized version have exercised no small influence on the English language. The Bible has been studied and quoted in English more than in any other Christian country. And a great many biblical phrases have passed into the ordinary language as household words. The best judges of English style have greatly admired the style of the authorized version, made under the direction of James in 1611, and have recommended an early familiarity with and the intensity pursues and the intensity perusal of the English Bible as the best training in English language. The Bible translators after Tyndale and Coverdale have contributed little by way of invention of words and phrases which have become part of the English vocabulary. But the indirect effect of the Bible has been felt down to the recent times. Now let's discuss the influence of Shakespeare in this language. Shakespeare, who was unrivaled in so many other ways, has exercised great influence on the English language than any other individual maker. Indeed, the influence of Shakespeare as a maker of English is very much of the same kind as that of the Bible translations, though its extent has been slightly slightly less fundamental and widespread than that of the Bible. He has made some valuable and permanent contribution to the English language by his dramatic use of dialect, especially his native dialect. Now let's discuss about the influence of Milton. Milton illustrates the fact that there is no constant relation between a writer's literary greatness or even the greatness of his fame and the extent of his influence on the language in which he writes his works. Though as a poet, it stands only second to Shakespeare, yet as a maker of English, he cannot claim a place just beside Shakespeare. While Shakespeare had contributed innumerable phrases to the common treasury of English diction, the Miltonic expressions, which have really become part of English language, which are very few. We have in this unit discussed about the origin of the English language, various language theories, which played an important role in the development of the language. We also discuss about the rise of the English language and how translations of Bible printing contributed in the development of the English language. The influence of Latin and Greek languages along with Shakespeare and Milton were very worthy in the process of making the English language more standardized. Here are some questions which will help you to check your progress about this unit. The first question is, what is the primary function of the language? Second question is, which two languages were mingled and resulted in the Middle English? Third question is, why were there are more number of words introduced from Latin? And fourth question is, by which time the English language had attained its present form? Thank you students for watching this video. See you next time with another unit. Namaskar.